Towards the end of the 19th century, Ireland was still recovering from the Great Famine, which had claimed the lives of 1 million men, women, and children. Another 1 million people had emigrated, causing the island's population to plummet even further. By the turn of the century, Ireland was still a country of tiny farmsteads. In contrast to the state of its economy, however, the country's literary and cultural community was thriving. This was the time of James Joyce, Oscar Wilde, George Bernard Shaw, and W.B. Yeats. The Irish people have always enjoyed a rich literary and musical tradition, even in the face of economic devastation, poverty, and persecution. Our proud cultural heritage could never be extinguished. The first decade of the 20th century saw momentous changes in the lives of Irish women, who rose in great numbers to establish themselves on the national stage. Groups such as the Society of United Irish Women and Inní na hÉireann were founded and were dedicated to achieving Irish independence and encouraging the revival of the Irish language and culture. Cumann na mBan was the women's wing of the Irish Republican paramilitary organisation, the Irish Volunteers. Many notable Irish women rose to prominence during this period, proudly engendering an Irish cultural revival and the right of Irish women to claim an equal share in its legacy. Thank you. The years immediately preceding the rebellion of 1916 saw turbulent changes in the Irish political landscape. As the 20th century dawned and Europe plunged closer to a catastrophic war, many Irish nationalists felt that the country's destiny was there for the shaping. The time for revolution had arrived. Stirrings of defiance emerged in the form of the Irish Republican Brotherhood, the Irish Volunteers, and the Irish Citizen Army. They all shared a common goal, the right of the Irish people to govern themselves. In Westminster, the Irish Parliamentary Party had long fought for an Irish Home Rule Bill to be passed. Its progress, however, had been repeatedly stifled by the British government, whose primary focus was on the approaching war with Germany. The question of Ireland, it seemed, would have to wait. The Norman invasion of the late 12th century marked the beginning of more than 700 years of British involvement in Ireland. Since that time, the history of this small nation has been defined by rebellions and uprisings. At its height, the British Empire was the largest empire in human history, ruling over one-fifth of the world's population. However, for all its dominance and colonial power worldwide, the defiance of its nearest neighbour, a small island in the North Atlantic, has been a thorn in the side of the British Empire for 700 years. Despite repeated attempts to stamp out our cultural identity by banning the Irish language, restricting social gatherings, and outlawing Irish sports and culture, our proud traditions survived and flourished. Despite the apparent isolation of Ireland, and the seemingly insurmountable odds it faced in the struggle for freedom, it was by no means without allies. The United Irish League spread rapidly both at home and abroad. The Irish Republican Brotherhood was a secret oath-bound organisation dedicated to the establishment of an independent, democratic Republic of Ireland. Its counterpart in the United States became known as the Fenian Brotherhood, and later Clan na Gael. The movement even had its supporters in Britain. The right of the Irish people to rise up against tyranny was recognised by many foreign governments. International support for the rising was substantial, which further emboldened the leaders in their march toward destiny. Thank you. On Easter Monday, April 24th, 1916, Irish volunteer leader Patrick Pearse stood in front of the General Post Office building on what is now O'Connell Street and read aloud for the first time the Irish Proclamation of Independence. He was joined by the other signatories of the document, among them Thomas Clark and James Connolly. This was to become the defining event in the history of the state. Their force comprised of a small number of men and women from the Irish Volunteers, the Irish Citizen Army, and Cumann na Mban. Key locations around Dublin were occupied and fortified in anticipation of the British response, which was swift and brutal. With vastly superior numbers and artillery, the British Army quickly suppressed the rising. By the following Thursday, in order to avoid further bloodshed and civilian casualties, Pearse agreed to an unconditional surrender. The leaders of the rebellion were marched to Kilmainham Jail, tried for treason, and executed. James Connolly, who had been wounded during the fighting and was unable to stand, was tied to a chair and shot by firing squad. With most of the rebel leaders executed, and Dublin city centre in smouldering ruins, the rising was initially seen as a catastrophic failure. However, the brutal tactics of the British Army and the subsequent executions of the rebel leaders turned public opinion against the British government. This galvanised the resolve of the Irish people, and succeeded in bringing physical force republicanism back to the forefront of Irish politics. An entire generation of young Irish men and women flocked to join the Irish Republican Army in defiance of British rule. So began the War of Independence. Finally, in 1921, the British government called a ceasefire and agreed to an Anglo-Irish treaty. This involved the partition of Ireland into North and South, the North remaining part of Britain, while the South became the Irish Free State and ultimately the Republic of Ireland. After almost a century of unrest in Northern Ireland following the division, the Good Friday Agreement was finally signed in 1998, bringing about a lasting peace between the two sides.
Ireland's role is unique, for every new nation knows that Ireland was the first of the small nations of the 20th century to win its struggle for independence.
Despite its troubled past, our small island and its people have had an undeniable influence on the world stage. With the diaspora spanning the globe, the Irish have brought their heritage, humour, and fighting spirit to every corner of the planet. From the great expansion of America to the colonization of the Antipodes, our proud nation has contributed much of the driving force behind many great world events and endeavors. Our once troubled relationship with our neighbors in Britain has blossomed into a partnership based on reconciliation, trade, and a shared heritage. We are a nation of poets and writers, musicians and film stars, sportsmen and statesmen.
The nation holds its breath. Yes!
The Ireland of today is a sovereign nation, democratic, peaceful, and free. Thanks to the sacrifice of a small band of patriotic men and women 100 years ago.